Thank you very much, Taoiseach. I really appreciate those words that I think were very, I think, very well put in the context of the 70th anniversary of our country as a republic. So, and for coming here today and for marking this occasion with some, I think, very well thought through words about the role of our sector and the place that we play in Irish society in building trust, in building community, in being part of what makes living in Ireland not potentially perfect, but a very, very good place to live and a very good society and not just an economy. So I think a very much welcome for those words, and particularly in the context of the fact that sometimes it can be hard to understand the complexity of this sector that is represented by such a diverse set of organisations, from large national service delivery organisations through to the glue in communities, the Meals on Wheels that keeps us all together, right through to the half a million volunteers, right through to the economic powerhouse of a workforce of almost 190,000 employees that offers much more than just, I guess, public service delivery, that offers a voice to communities and indeed doubles the investment or the money that comes in from the Exchequer through fundraising, through earned income, through a range of other income. So I think placing that in context, I think, is really, really welcome. And linking this in with some of the discussions that we had earlier today, and I want to express the appreciation really to the government approach to implementing what Paul mentioned was our call that was articulated in the programme for government for an overarching strategy that would look at the relationship between the sector and the state and would have a vision and a narrative for how, I guess, active citizenship can be put into the heart of, I guess, what you call civic republicanism. And I welcome the fact that the implementation of that promise in the programme for government through the Department of Rural and Community Development and three strategies on volunteering, social enterprise and the local and community development and voluntary sector is in play, yes, at the departmental level. And indeed, that the report, the Independent Review Group report, commissioned and recently published by the Department of Health, has a whole series of recommendations to play at that level. And of course, they will play out as departmental level. But what it offers, I think, and in the context of your words, it offers, I guess, a once-in-a-generation opportunity to place community engagement, to place those values that you spoke about, solidarity, caring for the other, volunteerism, looking out for each other and working together for the common good in the service of the public. I think that we do have, now that we have those things playing out at departmental level, an opportunity for the government as a whole to create, I guess, a roadmap for how that community engagement and how that sector, our sector, which is the engine, I guess, in a lot of ways of active citizenship, can be supported in the implementation of those policies. And I know that you are not, the various departments are playing that out, but that you are at all times a keen supporter of policy development and delivery, because I think there are still an ever, I guess, a more acute and urgent set of issues that we need the grand vision, the plan, the implementation of these policies and strategies to address. We have, just to name but a few, you mentioned the difficulty of people getting volunteers around the regulation, all good in and of itself, but there is a real complexity now about the reporting and the compliance, and there is a need to streamline that and indeed to fund the additional costs that requires organisations to take on in order to meet those requirements. There's a real need for certainty in funding levels as well as actual funding levels for the full cost of the public services that are delivered by voluntary organisations on behalf of the state. And this has potentially disastrous consequences on the impact of organisations' ability to retain and recruit staff, for example, just as a practical manifestation of that. Very simple practical issues around public procurement and reforming those processes so that social enterprises and community involvement can take place at level playing fields, and the need for trust building through a standard financial reporting template, to name but a few of those issues that are very acutely facing these organizations' ability to play their true potential role, I guess, in making that, I guess, vision that you articulated of a society that is engaged and committed and involved and with, marked by solidarity. So thank you for ensuring that these policies are in train and that have been given the priority that they deserve and that we require. It's interesting that when we look back and you made mention of where you were in previous years, on this day, on our conference day last year, our summit last year, was the day of the voting for the Repeal the 8th referendum. So it wasn't quite the date, but it was May 26th. When you commented on the yes vote, you said, "What we see is the culmination of a quiet revolution that has been taking place in Ireland for the past couple of decades." And that statement was a recognition of the hard work and long hours involved to bring about any major change in policy and social change itself. And you noted that role that the sector has in leading out on social change. I think it's noteworthy here today at a gathering of, I think, of, counting the number of chairs, 450 people from civil society organisations, was that the outstanding example, that referendum, and indeed the one a couple of 3 years before, were outstanding examples of where civil society played a hugely important role in terms of organising, communicating with the public, and doing it from a really important standpoint of independence, but really crucially doing it in partnership with an equally interested set of advocates in the political system and the statutory system. And it was the distinct roles of each sector, respectful of the unique and independent role of the other, that created a most unique and most successful momentum that delivered the outcomes. And that partnership of distinct, separate sectors, each making their own positive contribution to that public benefit, our sector right now wants to and needs to see that kind of partnership across a whole of government and a whole of department approach. Quite simply, if the sector is to continue to be and exemplify the best that community life can be, we need a new type of relationship with the state, one that is based on partnership of independent and distinctive equals, each with a unique and important role to play, but to create solutions for the societal changes and challenges that we collectively face. So, as a couple of people before me at this podium have noted, we're 20 years old today as an organisation. And with the membership of over 1,600 organisations, the journey over the last two decades has also been very hard work and long hours. It's an important anniversary for members in the wider sector too, because you have kept the wheel alive and thriving. And these years represent the bedding down of a vital voice, champion and resource for the development and shared interests of the sector. We kicked off the start of our 20th year in January this year with a long-awaited ambition of ours to open free membership for the Wheel forever for the smaller organisations of turnover of less than 25,000. So we were really proud to be able to do that. And the way we were able to do that was the power of numbers and the solidarity of the member numbers that marks both the sector's ambitions and solidarity and inclusion as well as the Wheel's work. I'd like to acknowledge and thank the work of all the board members here. And I'm conscious that I'm in the presence of the two sisters of our founder, Dr. Mary Redmond. And I want to thank them for coming and to acknowledge the vision that Mary had in those early days and those initial sector leaders that gathered around her. We saw Bernadette on the tape, and I know somewhere Sean Healy is in the audience, and there's too many to actually name, so we shouldn't have started. And I do know that they did say to me in those early days, "Deirdre, it's got a snowball's chance in hell of succeeding, but give it a lash anyway." So there you go. I'm obviously a little bit determined, not unlike yourself, in terms of making sure that success comes for the others and the members that we represent and support. So in closing, I want to say that there is a huge passion and energy and commitment here today and here always when you have a group of voluntary sector people coming together. Our sector is a caring, thriving community of organisations, groups, clubs, associations, charities and people. Yes, we face challenges, but we will never give up trying to make a positive difference because that is our DNA, that is what we do. Our contribution is literally enormous, and it is priceless. It's quite seriously, a price cannot be put on it. And it is the spirit of community that makes Ireland a great place to live. It's been a real privilege for us in the Wheel to support and serve our members in the wider sector and to play a part, our part, in amplifying their voice in the national dialogue. In the next 20 years, we will see the TECTA take its full and rightful place, front and centre in tomorrow's Ireland. And we'll be working with our partners, with our members across the sector and with government to make that ambition a reality. So I'd like to thank you. And as a gesture of our thanks, I'd like to present you with a gift made by one of our members. Gift of Hands is a community organisation and social enterprise based in the small village of Mulrani, County Mayo. My colleague Sinead is walking slowly towards us as I speak. As she hands you don't have to carry it for very long, Taoiseach, it's all right. The members make items from recycled items. They're discarded textiles and remnants from the local woolen mills. And with these scraps, they sew, they weave, they quilt, and they felt and construct items that many outlets across the country sell. And with the sales and the money from those sales, they invest that and distribute that across the community and voluntary organisations. Volunteer Tourist Office, the local men's shed, an environmental group, this local schools programme, and the Old Irish Goat Society, which is very importantly working to save Ireland's indigenous, almost extinct goat breed. So thank you, in closing, for your presence here today. It means a lot to our members to be here, so thank you very much. I know you have to leave, so I would just like to ask for an expression of appreciation for the people.